as we come down here into these woods, on our left-hand side, you might see that there are the remains of glades. And these are the glades and the openings through the woods that have remained as they were. This is a wood which has been partially planted and managed, but a lot of it is self-seeded. But it was here in this form on the same footprint that it is now in 1916. So any of the British troops coming up through towards the Leipzig Redoubt, which is directly behind us, would have come up through these glades that we're driving on. But we're obviously going in the opposite direction so that we can go into the museum down in Albert. As you come down here, looking to the ground on your left, and you can see the remains of shell holes in through this wood, and these are the remains of British high explosives that have been fired over from south of Albert into the German positions that were on this part of the ridge prior to the advance on the 1st of July. And the British had got about 800 artillery pieces south of Albert, and they were firing anything up to 15 rounds a minute, depending on the size of them. If you turn to page 10, you can see it looks about a 12 or a 15 inch diameter howitzer, and that would have been firing pieces. This is south of Albert. That would have been firing over into the area that we're driving through now. And it wasn't in the tens or the hundreds, it was in the thousands of tons of artillery that was fired in the fortnight leading up to the 1st of July from the far side of Albert into this ground that we're driving over now. Around this corner, you can look down into a field on the right, and you can see at the shallow field, which had a dressing station in it, you can tell how sheltered it was just by the amount that we dropped down into this valley. We're coming out of Nab Valley. On our right hand side is Blighty Valley, and that's Blighty Valley Cemetery. Those that survived the medical dressing station with their wounds knew that they were on their way back to Blighty, and that's how it got its name. Those that didn't survive have been buried in the cemetery here, and that was a cemetery that was set up by the burial party that were attached to the dressing station that was in the field just next to the cemetery. All clear, we're back into Aldair. We'll finish off for today, but tomorrow we'll be on the southeast side of the Roman Road, and on Sunday morning we'll be on the northern side of the Roman Road, which then will take us up through Avaloy Woods, which are the woods that you can see over on our right-hand side. So, as you can imagine, the glade that we just come through, the wood over on our right is sort of very similar glades, and that was also used for storage of munitions. So the large munitions dumps in the woods over on our right, but we'll pick those up on Sunday morning as we're travelling north. down on by the guns positioned up on our left, but also the guns were, which were in Pontier Village. Pontier is up on the ridge at 2 o'clock. You can just see the church spire there. And this was known and was marked on British and Commonwealth maps at the time as Death Valley. Up at 2-3 o'clock on our right-hand side, you can see Pontier Memorial. There will be something there tomorrow evening. 10,500 names on the wall and 2,500 burials within the cemetery that are surrounded by the monumental walls up there. And the majority of those are bodies that were brought in from these valleys around here, and also names of those who were known to have fought from this sector of the Battle of Arras, but whose bodies have never been identified.
There are a couple of breeze blocks on the left-hand side of the track. That's the point that you are
within, or if you were here 100 years ago, you would have been within the German barbed wire entanglement that was set up in front of the defensive trenches that were on this little high point of the land here. And it's only maybe a few metres above the surrounding area, but if you sit and look around you, you have several hundred metres of view in either direction from this field here. Markings on them mean that there is going to be a walking and cycling competition tomorrow, so we're going to be predominantly on the far side of the Roman Road and the radio mast that we can see up on the horizon, so hopefully we won't be competing with walkers and cyclists. quite often at this time of the year that we, when we're coming down these gullies, that we can see the outlines of the trenches because of the amount of chalk that was brought up to the surface when they dug them. There are still quite often white lines visible on the surface of the fields, but it doesn't look as though we can see anything. I was expecting to see some between us and the cemetery at 10 o'clock, and out to our right in the field, but we can't see any at all. We're now in between the first and second German lines, which were protecting Corselet Village, which is the village in the trees ahead of us. And just about where this old tree is standing up on its own on the side of the track is where the second line of trenches went out over the field on our right. And down in the valley on our left was a machine gun position, which was able to look straight up the valley, but also in front and behind it, up over the ridges to our left and right. For those of you that are in the passenger seat and have the booklet, I think the front cover shows a group of vehicles just driving past Corselet Cemetery. It's this cemetery up on our left hand side, and we're going to go down a little bit further and then back up and go up over the Tierpole Ridge back towards the memorial, which is over our left hand shoulders. We'll be driving past the front of this cemetery, which is on the other side of the field here. Around the corner, if you're able to see through the dust of the tractor and our vehicle, between us and the cemetery, once we're on the tarmac, there were four machine gun positions all looking up over the ridge, which is on our left hand side. Thank you. The German trench line on your right hand side. We're now running along the front of a German defensive position, which at the crossroads cuts across in front of us and goes out across this field at 45 degrees. But there was also a sport line railway track which ran out over the fields on our right towards the wind turbines that you can see at 2 o'clock. Just in the pile of rubble on our left, just have a look next to the vehicles, you can see some of the artillery pieces that have been brought up and piled there ready for the bomb disposal people to take away and dispose of.
Can we just pause there a second and get a photograph of that?
Yeah, sure, we'll hang on here. As we come along here, we can just make out on the over the horizon the top of the Yerevan Memorial. That's 57 metres tall, the flag poles on the top. So you can work out how much of a drop there is ahead of us. But just between 1 and 2 o'clock, you can see a wooded area. And that's out towards the Schwaben Redoubt, which was part of the target or the objective on the first day for the Irish division that were coming out of Tietbal Wood. And they advanced and managed actually to get into the redoubt, but the supporting troops weren't able to keep up with them and they ended up having to retire back towards their starting line. And we're now just coming over this ridge onto the front of the, or sorry, onto the back of Tietbal Ridge, with the Pottier Ridge over on our left hand side. the trees on our left hand side, you can just see some farm buildings. This is Mulcahy Farm. It was taken by the Australians when they were advancing in onto Pontier Village, which is over our left shoulders. They knew it as Mucky or Mukau Farm, and the Australian government are in negotiations to buy that because of the phenomenal loss of life that was inflicted on the Australians when they were going in to take it. The Australian government wants to buy the land so that they can turn it into a national memorial. There is a plot of land behind the farm which is completely untouched since 1916, that hasn't been cultivated in any way for 100 years, and we can still, from the road, we'll be able to see that there's still quite a lot of obvious shell damage in that part of the land. But the rest of it has been put back to agriculture, just as the fields that we're travelling through now. But we're now travelling through the defence lines, which came out of the position at Mulcahy Farm, and they ran across the track at 90 degrees, left and right, from the farm, out across this track, and out in through the field on our right-hand side. Phenomenal barbed wire systems and communication trenches behind frontline defensive trenches. anybody likes vintage farm machinery, I can see a great Fuji down there with a couple of old Renaults. I don't know when this show is going to be on, but there's something happening at the moment. Coming out of there on your left. Just around the corner.
Yeah, if we can stop, please. Can we take a photograph?
Yeah, that's fine. Not a problem. Here looking up towards the memorial, the middle ground between us, which has got a rise on it, had another German defensive system just to cover the rear of the chateau grounds, which are up where the memorial is, and that looped round up to the trees, which you can see there's a clump of trees on the skyline at about 2 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, and that's the Schwaben Redoubt, and that was one of Leipzig Redoubt, and that was one of the most strongly defended areas of the Tietmel Ridge, and it was because they could see right down into the valley on the other side. They had a clear view down this valley here and across the fields, and the land up in front of us and to our left that we can't see from this position. There's a phenomenal underground bunker system built into that ridge up there that had got several hundred men garrisoned in it at any one time. So Monday, we're just aware of the time moving on towards our dinner date this evening. So we're going to go and have a look at the memorial, but not go into the visitor centre. We'll leave that for Monday lunchtime. I've used the majority of the mount as the right, but if you have a look at out of your left window, just in line with the telegraph wires that are running on your left, is another German trench line system. So you can see just from where we are now, a couple of metres up onto that ridge, they would have had a view down into the valley that we've just been in. When we were travelling up and we had Pozières Memorial on our right hand side, this is the ridge. We're now just over the ridge on the other side. So that's where people would have been targeted by the Germans who were on this ridge on our left when they were in Death Valley, just maybe 600 yards to our left. passenger seat and have the map handy on page 4. You can, just above Albert, and to the right of the red line, which signifies the front line on the 1st of July, you can see Tiet Vau. That's the ridge up on our right-hand side. So you can see how far, or how close, actually, the ridge and the village were to the front line on the 1st of July.
Well, there we are, the view at the entrance to Jet Malvern. Nobody else gets, we're the only ones we believe that come down here. By far the nicest approach to the memorial, we believe. South Africans who were killed and who were named on the memorial here, impregnated into his skin with some dye. They were then photographed, and the photographs were these pieces of art which were hanging from the poles that you're in between now, but the fabric has been blown away just in the time that they've been hanging up there, and all that's left is the black poles. Somewhere out of view, we'll leave the vehicles here.